My presentation is Surviving and Thriving in Troubled Times. You could get the phone call and suddenly you find out a family member is in crisis. Some of you are there. You could be in an accident. You could lose a job. There are so many ways that you could find yourself in troubled times. And what I'm going to be talking about today is we will be looking at survival characteristics of those who survive in dangerous situations. And we're going to be applying them to our spiritual and emotional survival. Because, folks, if you don't survive spiritually, it doesn't matter if you survive physically. You could be a broken, miserable person. And you don't want to be that. And so we're going to be looking at those. And, right before I get in that, I should just say, we could also be in really tough survival times just in world events. If you haven't noticed, our world is coming apart at the seams. And I see a lot of faces here that I haven't seen during the week. I would really and strongly encourage you to go to our website, islamandchristianity.org, or to go to get our books or DVDs or something. Because the world that we live in right now, the events that are going on right now, were clearly depicted in prophecy 2,500 years ago. And that being a conflict where radical Islam pushes against papal-led Christianity, and papal-led Christianity calls for military action against radical Islam. That happened in the summer of 2014. The next thing up would be that there would be a move to eradicate radical Islam. And as of January 20, the President of the United States says that's exactly what he intends to do, with a world organization, a world confederacy to do that. And that's what the prophecy called for. Friends, it's what's called the whirlwind, the last quick events of the Daniel 11 prophecy. I'm not going to go into that anymore right now, but if you don't understand it, you haven't been here, you owe it to yourself to check it out. So now, what is it going to take to survive and thrive when anything goes wrong, either in your personal life or in the whole world? Number one, attitude is key to survival. Romans 8:28 and Philippians 1. Here's what Romans 8:28 says. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. How many things work together for good? All things. The worst that's happened to you, the worst you've ever done, God will take all of them and use them for good if you surrender them to Him. Last week I shared how God has done that for us. It makes a difference in your attitude when you actually believe that. Look at what Paul's hope and attitude was. It's an attitude of hope that God will eventually take care of all this stuff. For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Christ Jesus, Jesus Christ. According to my earnest expectation and hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. Did you catch that? He's pretty determined no matter what, life or death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. For if I live on in the flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor, yet what shall I choose I cannot tell, for I am hard pressed between the two. A choice between life or death, man, that's a tough choice. Listen to what Paul's saying here. This guy's got an attitude of hope. Continuing. Having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better, nevertheless to remain in the flesh is more needful to you. And being confident of this, I know that I shall remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy of the faith. And then verse 29. I shared this with a pastor this week that was going through a very difficult time. For to you it has been granted on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in Him, but also to suffer for His sake. How many of us, the first response we have when trouble breaks on us is, Praise the Lord, God's granted me the privilege to suffer for Jesus. That's Paul's attitude. How are you going to discourage this guy? Oh, they say, hey, Paul, renounce your faith or we're going to kill you. Praise the Lord. What do you mean, praise the Lord? Well, the next thing I know, I'd be spending eternity with him. Go ahead, praise the Lord. Well, then we're going to throw you in jail. Praise the Lord. What do you mean, praise the Lord? We're going to make sure there's guards there and you can't leave. You mean the guards can never leave? No. Praise the Lord. Paul's thinking, I can share the gospel with them and they can't leave. They've got to stay. I've got a captive audience. And it said in Caesar's own household, people were being converted by Paul to the gospel of Jesus Christ. So they let him go. And he went out and shared the gospel on another missionary trip. How are you going to stop this guy? You see, if you have the attitude of Christ, they can't stop you. Keep that in mind. So attitude and hope are key to survival. Think the unthinkable. Things will not always continue as they are now. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman. And they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. Folks, we've got a world that's striving for peace and safety. But it's going to blow up in their faces. Keep that in mind. Peter says it this way, knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days, walking according to their own lust and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. We've got to think the unthinkable. It won't always stay good. By the way, if it's bad now, it won't always stay bad either. God will work through something. But if you think everything's going smooth, just wait till tomorrow. Maybe it won't be. Just take it one day at a time and let God work through the day with you. But we do need to be thinking the unthinkable. You see, there's this 10-80-10 principle. In a crisis situation, 10% of people will panic and become dangerous to themselves and others. 80% will kind of go numb and wait to be told what to do. And 10% will have thought through things and will be alert and will be good for themselves and for others. By the way, if you're following God's word, you should know what's coming and you should be ready to lead people that aren't sure what to do. I was teaching rock climbing, and I've taught a lot of people rock climbing. And I have a couple of major goals when I'm climbing. Keep a body from falling on rocks. And keep rocks from falling on bodies. Those are my major goals. Along with that, it is my intention to make sure young people have a wonderful time. Scare them to death, but have a wonderful time. Both of them are key. Why? Because if you don't give young people something to go tell their friends about, look what I did, they'll go do something stupid. And so I tried to do something with manageable risk where they can go brag to their friends about what they did, but I can manage the risk while we're doing it. It works pretty good. But you've got to think the unthinkable. I'm laying on a tree one day belaying. Now, normally you're belaying and you're with your neck up looking at your climber. If you're doing a sport climb where it goes up and the rope goes back down to them. And so as they're climbing and you're pulling the loose rope out, and if they fall, you just twist your hand to the side. Boom, you've got them. My wife's a great belayer. She can stop people 2 or 3 times her weight. No problem. They're not always so sure about that, but we know she can do it. So this one day, I found a tree that's growing at an angle, and so I'm just laying on the tree, and I'm not getting a bad neck at all that day. I thought it was great. And my climber's going up just off to my right, and we're climbing a cliff we've never climbed on before. Nobody probably ever climbed on it before. It's out in the mountains of Arkansas, not where they were climbing. It's kind of an interesting cliff. It goes up and comes out and goes up. As he was working his way up, I'm watching him and I'm thinking the unthinkable. If he knocks rocks loose, There's a big angled surface over here of rock. If it hits that, my guess is, playing the pool, this isn't a good spot to be. So I said, hey, there's a little ledge there. Grab hold of it. Hang on for a bit. I'm going to move my anchor over past this tree a little bit. So I move my anchor. And he starts off again. And the next ledge he gets to, just moments later, he grabs this ledge and he pulls up on it. When I say ledge, it at least it's more than a handhold. It was a ledge. And he grabs hold of it and a couple hundred pounds of rock rip off that whole section. And he swings out on his rope, and he told me later his first thought is, I'm killing my belayer, I'm going to die next. And he swings out on the rope, he's in no problem. And as it comes down, it hits that angled rock, blasts right over, rips the bark off the tree that I'd been laying on. I got hit by one chunk of rock, I saw it coming. I can't move, really. Okay, I'm anchored in. And I've got his weight swinging on me. I can't move. But I could lift the weight off my feet just as my leg got hit. And it spun me in a somersault. But I came up holding his rope. He was very grateful. But that's what I'm talking about. You've got to think ahead, or we've both been dead. Law enforcement, military guys, they're always thinking ahead about what could go wrong. If you're a law enforcement or served much time in the military, when you came in here, you had basically a plan of what would do if something went really wrong in here today. Most law enforcement, military guys are that way. Because they've trained to think the unthinkable. I remember one kid, tell you about the panic side. We were teaching rappelling. Now, rappelling is really simple. All you have to do is put your heels over the edge and lean backwards. Of course, you've got a rope and a harness on, and I don't right now. But it's like you sit down on nothing, a sit harness, and you push out and away from the rock. If you've never done it before, it's a little scary the first time. But remember, I'm out here to scare kids and give them a good time at the same time. So this particular kid, I'm sliding my hand down the rope as he moves over the edge. He says, I can't do this. I'm saying, yes, you can. He doesn't realize it, but I'm literally stiff-arming him over the edge. As his every little movement on his rappel device, I'm taking him over. He's too scared to notice that kind of stuff. And as he's working over, I said, you know, as soon as your rope touches down on the edge of this climbing tower platform, it's going to be just fine. It gets really easy after that. He did not believe me. He's going down, and just as it touches down, he looks at me, and he says, I can't do this, and I won't do this. I said, okay. I'll tell you what, it's going to be a lot easier to go down from where you are than to get you back up. I said, you cannot fall. We've got you. I have a guy on the ground. This got him. All he has to do is pull on the rope, and this guy can't move. And the kid looks at me and says, no, I won't do it. And he reached over to unhook his harness. He just flipped out. Thankfully, I was within reach. I grabbed his rope, swung over the edge. By this time, my guy on the ground is pulling hard on the rope. This guy's not going anywhere, except if he comes out of the harness. And we have nothing to stop him from that. And so I just slid my hand down on his rappel device. I knew I wouldn't go down any further than that. And I kicked hard. And I nailed him. I got him right on his knuckles reaching for that harness buckle. And the pain brought him back to reality. Before he could grab me, I swung back up, grabbed another rope, hooked in and went back in and hooked him in. And I wasn't letting him out of my reach. And that's what happens if you panic. You've got to stay open, let the Lord lead you, and be aware of what's going on around you. Story listening is crucially important for survival as well. 1 Corinthians 10. Now all these things have happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition upon whom the ends of the ages have come. Therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the way of temptation will also make the way of escape, that you may be able to bear it. The Bible is full of stories of people who have walked difficult roads ahead of you. And God brought them through. Trust him, he will bring you through as well. Read the stories. But story listening is crucially important. You may remember the story of Captain Sullenberger. Miracle on the Hudson. As he was having his co-pilot fly the plane on takeoff. As they were climbing up there by New York City, away from the airport, they hit a flock of birds. It put both engines out. The aircraft voice recorder recorded Captain Sullenberger saying, "The aircraft is mine," meaning he's now flying it. He's in control. And he tells the co-pilot to go through the restart engine procedures. They never did restart. They radio in and say, "We just lost both engines," and they are cleared to land at a nearby airport, and Captain Sullenberger says, "Negative, we're in the Hudson." Was he in the Hudson River yet? No. But he'd already made his decision. You see, Captain Sullenberger had gone through all kinds of stories. He read the stories of other aircraft disasters, and he wasn't. He was learning from all of them. I was just thinking, praise team, I talked about an aircraft. It's not Sullenberger. It's another guy at the end. Don't get up right now. And he heads for the Hudson River, because he doesn't believe he can make it to that runway, and if he falls short of the runway, he'll kill everybody inside his airplane, and he'll kill people on the ground. That is not an option to him. He's going to put it down on the Hudson. And you have one chance for a perfect water landing if you ever want to fly a plane again. You know, you only get one chance at this thing. If you miss it, you're done. And he brings it in, perfect water landing. This picture of the airplane was taken just moments later when everybody was already out of the airplane waiting for the ferry boat to pick them up. The people that got hurt basically got hurt standing on the wet wing waiting for the ferry, slipping and falling. So, called a miracle on the Hudson. Just afterwards, there was another airplane disaster in New York. This one, a commuter plane crashed in the houses, killing everybody on the plane and people in the houses. What was the difference? You see, Captain Sullenberger had a hobby of reading the stories and learning from them. The other pilot, unfortunately, did not flip it off autopilot in icing conditions. That airplane regulations are not to fly it in icing conditions because autopilot will crash that plane with ice. A human can fly it okay. He left it on, and it crashed it. Which one would you rather fly with? The one that learned from the stories. It's the only one you could fly with, by the way. Trust in God is crucial. Psalm 23, verses 4 through 6. "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." By the way, did that say you will never go through tough times? Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, and I've been there. But God was with us. 1 John 4:18, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love." Folks, if you are looking ahead at end time events and you're scared to death, it's time to focus on Jesus Christ. Because end time events, oh, they could be tough, but if you're living in fear, you're missing that Jesus rescues his people in those tough times. And that you're not on your own. Jesus takes care of it. That's what you have to be focused on. Daniel 3. Daniel's friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, were told to be out on the plains of Dura and bow down and worship a gold image when the music played. And if anybody didn't bow down, they would be thrown into a fiery furnace. The music played. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did not bow. I mean, we're not talking a little bow. We're talking face down to the ground bow. And they're standing up. Think anybody's going to notice? Yeah. And they get called to the king. He says, oh, you guys, you're those guys that were 10 times smarter than everybody else. You must have missed the announcement. You're smart enough to bow down. I'm going to play the music again. This time, just bow down and everything will be fine. I like you guys. By the way, if you want to know how the aggravated king, try what they did next. Here's what they said. He said he's going to play the music again. He said, if that is the case, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you set up. You can play the music all day if you want, king. We're not doing it. Our God can beat you. And if he doesn't, we're still not doing it. That got him mad. And he says, heat it up 7 times hotter, then throw them in. So in other words, make it as hot as you can make it. And they had pit furnaces, which means it's just kind of a pit in the ground, and they had oil tubes into it, and they put oil in there, and they had bellows, and they'd just make these pits as hot as they could for brick kilns. And so they're pouring it in and pumping away on the oxygen, and it's just roaring. And they tie Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego up, their feet and their arms, which means, are Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego going to go jump in the pit on their own? Besides, they weren't going to do that on their own. And so somebody grabs them by the shoulder and somebody else by the feet, and they come running over to the edge and they toss them in. By the way, would you come and just drop them right over the edge into this billowing furnace? Or would you throw them from as far away as you think you can get away with it? Which means they're going to bounce off the edge and on in. It is so hot, the guys that are throwing them fall over dead. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego bounce down in there. And they get up and dust off and start walking around in the fire. Nebuchadnezzar, who's up on a platform where he can see in, he turns to his guys beside him and said, didn't we throw 3 people into the fire? Why do I see 4 walking around in the fire and the 4th one looks like the Son of God? And then he says, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, come up out of the fire. Did you notice who he didn't call out? The 4th one can stay. He doesn't want to see him any closer. Friends, when God shows up to deliver his people, the people that have been attacking him get kind of nervous. Jesus can stay in the fire, but Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, what if you're them? You were just out there a bit ago and they tried to kill you. You're in here in the fire. Nobody but nobody's coming in here after you. And you're walking around with Jesus. Tell you what I'd do. I'd look at Jesus and say, do I have to leave? I mean, you're with Jesus and nobody bothering you. Kind of a warm place. And Jesus says, I think we've got his attention. You can go now. And they come up. And as they come up out of the fire, the ropes have been burned away. But there's not even this hint of the smell of fire on them. Have you ever reached near a candle and had those little hairs on the back of your knuckle go, psst? What's it smell like? Not so good, right? I saw a guy that just had all of his hair blown off in a flash fire. It was still literally sticking straight back and down his back. It didn't smell so good, but the burned flesh and the burned hair. These guys have been walking around in a fire. Didn't hurt him. Yeah. When you're with God, he can take you through all kinds of stuff. So trust in God is crucial. What they know from military personnel, study of aircraft carrier pilots. You know, they land on moving runways that are not only moving in distance, but up and down. They have all kinds of jokes about the different ways of die on takeoff and landing. Why do they joke about it? You either need to deal with it in humor or some other way, Because if you don't name your fear, it's harder to control it. So they joke about it. Here's the best way to name your fear. Lord, I don't like what's happening. It's all yours. Give it to God and trust Him. Then if you want to joke about it, okay. But give it to God first. Being alert and learning to listen. 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. There was a lady jogging down in California. This was several years ago. And, you know, let me back up for a moment. When I was a young person and involved in all kinds of rock climbing and backpacking experiences, I was told that the common knowledge was mountain lions do not attack people. But somewhere not too long after that, they stopped teaching that in mountain lion school. And mountain lions started killing people. It has changed in my lifetime. And so this lady is jogging down in California when suddenly she is hit from behind very hard, a mountain lion. He drives her face down, and she can feel his fangs on her skull. And she can feel his fangs sliding against the bone of her skull. And he's moving, headed down towards her neck. She knows if he gets to her neck, she's dead. And she can describe the feel of his breath and the fangs sliding on her skull. She is alert. She doesn't tune out. She can describe the feel of his fur as she reaches around and pets him. As she's looking for his eyes so she can gouge them out. And she gets his eyes. And he decides to go find lunch somewhere else. She's a survivor. She's alert and she doesn't tune out. Lots of people go black. Ask the Lord to help you deal with your fears so that you can stay alert. Isaiah says, your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it, whenever you turn to the right hand or whenever you turn to the left. The Holy Spirit has promised that He will lead you and guide you. He will tell you things, and He does, if you'll listen. And I've actually had people tell me He doesn't, but He does. You've heard it. Don't do it. Don't do it. That's still a small voice. Or He's encouraging you to go do something. Learn to listen and follow what He tells you. Your life will get better. A whole lot more exciting, by the way, too, because He'll get you into all kinds of stuff you would never have done otherwise. I'm walking home from playing floor hockey when I was in high school. Now, I live in the woods out in a valley. So I walk across a university campus, cross a road on the edge of the campus, and goes down a hill, and I go through a professor's yard, down the hill, into the woods, and as I'm going along, it's a March night, it's wet, it's a day about like this, like last night was. So it's overcast and rainy and cool, and I'm walking along on this trail with my arms in front of me, very carefully feeling for the trail because there's these little saplings along the trail, just off of the trail. Do you know what happens if you bump a sapling in that kind of a night? You take a cold shower. That was not my goal. And so I'm walking very slowly, and I do have my arms out just in case I get off the trail. It's really nasty to take one in the face. And so as I'm walking along, right off to the side about where this front pew is, I hear a little hop, hop. There's a rabbit. And it's very relaxed, occasional hops. He's just going along doing his stuff. He doesn't know I'm here. I thought, I wonder, because I'm going to be coming along. There's going to be this big tree, and my trail turns and goes right down in the same direction of where he's headed. How close can I come to bumping into this rabbit in the middle of the night? I can't see him, but I can hear him. I know he's there. He doesn't know I'm here. This is fun. And so I'm coming around this big tree when all of a sudden a voice goes off in my head that says, say hello, you are not alone. Huh? Say hello, you are not alone. I'm thinking, I'm in trouble. I'm hearing voices. I was young. I hadn't been listening to the Holy Spirit a lot yet. And as I'm standing there, I'm arguing with this voice in my head. It would be foolish to say hello. I am alone. You are not alone. Say hello. The rabbit doesn't even know I'm here. If I wasn't alone, that rabbit wouldn't be acting like it is. And the voice says, if the rabbit doesn't know you're here, why would he know somebody else is here? Say hello. I'm in real trouble. I'm losing to a voice in an argument. And then I get this thought, and I think this was my thought. If I'm not alone, I could hide behind this big tree. Uh-oh. I walk this trail all the time in the dark. It's going to go down, hang a hard right turn. I'm going over the creek. And then my house is off there in the distance, and I can see the lights to it. Say hello, you're not alone. It would be foolish. If you're not alone, nobody would know. I'm really losing. Okay, I'll say hello. And I'll hide behind the tree if I need to. Do you know how hard it is to say hello to nobody in the middle of the night? It's foolish. But then again, if nobody's there, nobody would know. Hello? Before I could hide behind the tree, I was blinded by a very bright light. What I didn't know is I had just walked up from about me to this lady. I had walked up behind an armed man laying beside the trail waiting in ambush for someone coming the other direction. And he did not know I was there. Is it a good idea to surprise somebody waiting in ambush? An armed man? No, this is not good. And he had whipped around and thankfully lit me up with his searchlight, not poked holes with me with his gun. But both were out. He wanted to know who I was. I wanted to know who he was. I will just tell you, the guy with the gun has the advantage. And I answered who I was. I said, I live here in that house right over there. Who are you and what are you doing here? He was a game warden. You see, that's a salmon spawning stream that I lived along. And we were having poaching trouble. And he was waiting for a poacher. He was laying along the trail waiting for a poacher to come along the creek. He'd been listening to a rabbit hopping straight towards him. He was wondering how close the rabbit was going to get. We were listening to the same rabbit that was headed to the spot where he was laying, and we didn't know about each other. I just have a question. Would my chances of survival go down if I would have quietly kept walking and bumped into him? An armed officer. This is close enough to surprise him. But if you are within arm's reach, you're likely to get shot first, questions later. I'm glad I listened to a voice. Have you learned to listen? Important to do. Flexible preparedness and the new normal. 2 Timothy 2:15. Be diligent to present yourself approved of God, to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightfully dividing the word of truth. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Always be ready, right? And one of the things we always have to do is be able to answer the question, how can I be a Christian? You need to have that one. And if you don't know that one, get our seminar presentation, outline one, with a gospel presentation on and memorize it. It may change your life. But it says there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end is the way of death. You can make all kinds of preparation, but if you're not relying on God, you can make some serious mistakes. This is my brother in what's coming through what's called the Needle Eye and Fit and Beauty Cave and along the Buffalo River in Arkansas. I was an approved guide for this cave. You take at least four, no more than eight, into it, 18 miles of passages, and there are no signposts in there. The leader has to know the cave. And so basically, I've got that thing memorized. Now, my brother's coming through the needle's eye. He's already put his helmet on. He's through the tight part. And because you cannot crawl through, you've got to slide through with your arms ahead of you. You got to take any backpack off you've got, little tiny thing. You go shove your stuff through, and then you slide through. Just as he comes out the other side, it's harder to see, but there's his helmet and there's his feet. And it's a long ways down to the floor of where you come out of the needle's eye, and it's a long ways up to the ceiling. It's a big room. There are many rooms much larger than this in that cave. And so he's in there. And there's all kinds of neat stuff to look at in there. And my knee standing beside what's called a bridal veil. I mean, it comes out of this brown, ugly mud, and it's sparkly white. God can make beauty out of anything, even your messed up life. And my messed up life. But anyway, he's a specialty in that. This particular caving trip, I was taking a group of eight, my 10-year-old son, my two teenage daughters, my teenage niece and her 19-year-old weightlifter boyfriend that I was meeting for the first time, and a 20-something couple. She's a nurse, upper 20s, and he's a contractor. Interesting team that we had, eight of us. I'm the oldest guy. And we head in. And now, it probably was a little dicey for most people going in, but we had flash flood warnings out that morning. And it had rained really hard the day before. But I'm going in early on Sunday morning, and I'm going to be hitting the trail just around sunrise. And I figured that if the flash floods are low enough that I can make it to the cave, they're going to come down during the day, and I can make it back out. And so we hit the first crossing, and it's normally ankle-deep water. And it wasn't ankle-deep water this morning, and I wasn't expecting it to be. And I have the young contractor belay me across. I tie a rope around my waist, and I head into the water. And I've got a branch, and I'm bracing downstream with the branch. And it's white water, but it's only running about this deep. I don't know if you've ever been in white water. That's deep to walk across. And I'd already tied the end of my rope up high on a tree on his side. I walk across, get to the other side, and I tie my rope off really tight to another tree running about 8 feet above the water. The rope now. And I bring my group one at a time across an Anatolian traverse. There are three crossings, but technically if I can make one of them, I can make it to the cave and get back. And so I leave my caving rope, which means I just lost the lower level of the cave. I can't rappel down into the lower part. But that's okay. We're going to take a lot of time just getting there today, so... Oh, I will tell you this. It's a four-wheel drive road to the parking spot. And so we get there, and I put my permit in this little lockbox, and on there I have to say when I'm leaving the parking spot and when I'm going to be back. If I don't make it back in time, they're supposed to send a rescue team after me and my group. It's that kind of a place. And so I'm on my way in, and I'm constantly thinking about my time out because I've got to be back on time. And so we're going in. We get to the second crossing. This one, I've helped carry people across because I'm wearing fast, dry pants, but some of my team is wearing blue jeans. You guys from the Northwest know the saying, cotton kills. And so I was working across, carrying people, did it on the third crossing. We got into the cave. The cave has got this door that's kind of at an angle. It's a locked prison-like door. Spin the combination, open the lock, pull the door open, we drop down inside, pull it shut and lock it, and we're in. You let make sure everybody in the group knows the combination. Because in case I get hit on the head, they can get out. And so we're in there. And we start, and we do it was only about a 6 or 8 hour trip instead of the normal 12 because it took us so long to get there and it knew it's going to take us a little time to get out. By the way, it is a packet-in, packet-out cave. That means if you have to go to the bathroom, you pack it out. And so we're in there, and on our way out, I should tell you, I slipped setting up a rope ladder to go down a 15-foot hole. In the process, I cracked a rib. But what do you do for a cracked rib that isn't out of place? You just Wait for it to quit hurting a couple of weeks later. Done that a couple of times. So anyway, we're in there, and on the way out, I get to the out room, big room, and up around the corner, there's this passage that goes to the gate, and I see a strobe light flashing out there. I'm thinking, why do they have a rescue vehicle out here? Then I thought, there's not even a road within 2 miles of here. They can't get a rescue vehicle here. What is that strobe light? I get to the opening, and there's a waterfall coming into the opening. There's not supposed to be a creek there. But we've got a massive waterfall coming in. Made it really hard to open the lock. But we got out, and outside there was water gushing down the mountains everywhere. You see, what happened, we went in at a flash flood level. And another thunderstorm came in and stalled out and sat there and poured heavy rain for over 6 hours. We're now looking at something like a 100-year event. And I made one serious mistake. I took my team and I left the cave. This is December. And before the night was over, it would be snowing. And we left because I knew I had a Natrolian traverse over that river. Creek that is now a river. And I thought I could make it back to my car. I only had to cross once. And we need to be flexible enough to change as things change. We have a set, determined plan. And we ignore scripture evidence to the contrary. And we continue with our plan or the way we always see things. We need to be prepared, but flexibly prepared, all right? Willing to change when new evidence comes along. Well, I got my team out and back to the trail. And I went upstream, which was only probably 50 yards or so, to the fourth crossing. Upstream. And I went alone because I wanted to see it by myself. And I got there, and I did not like what I saw. This is now a raging river. And I waded into the water just a little bit. And instantly, I wasn't even in the current yet, and it was still going down, and I was up to here. And I'm standing in the water looking downstream, and I'm looking at a 4-foot standing wave in brush. That's a strainer. You get swept into that, your chances aren't real good. And I thought, I can't take my group across here. I'm going to lose somebody. And from that moment on that night, my decisions were based on what was least likely to kill somebody in my group. I went back to them, and we headed downstream. And the trail went into the creek, and there was no way to cross it. And the only alternative is to go up the cliff beside it and find a ledge that goes through. And so in the middle of the night, with the wind blowing and the lightning flashing and the rain pouring, we prayed that when I picked a ledge, it would be one that actually went all the way across the cliff face to the other side. Because we couldn't see that far. And we went up, I skipped a ledge or two, and I found one, I said, this one. And I headed across, and I was looking down into raging water slamming into the cliff, and it's up beside us, and there's mud on this thing, and we're working our way across. And I'm praying. We got across that one, had to push through greenbrier walls of briars like your blackberries. It shredded our ponchos and our coats and our skin. We were pushing towards the car where we had dry clothes and food. My 10-year-old started to cry, Daddy, I'm cold. I'm tired. I need to take a nap. You might know what that means. I said, no, we've got to keep moving. And he kept crying. And we got to a wide spot on the second time we were crossing a cliff face, and I gathered my group together, and he's crying and begging that we can just stop and take a nap. And I said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to look in your packs, and I want you to leave everything here that you don't need for survival. If you don't need it tonight, I don't care how valuable it is. You don't carry it, because I don't want you wasting any energy carrying something you don't need. And I don't care about litter tonight. And if you have any food in that pack, I want you to eat it now. You need every calorie you've got. Temperature was dropping. And I watched the husband and wife pull out an apple core. That's all they had left. So he ate half of it and she ate half. And I turned to my son who wants to take a nap. And I said, Michael, if we stop moving tonight, we will die. We must move all night. He looked at me and said, oh. He never cried again. We kept moving. Somebody said, I've got to go to the bathroom. I said, are you wet? Yeah. Could you get any wetter? No. Would it be warm or cold? Warm. Got it. It's the only warmth anybody felt that night. Got an idea how bad it was? We got to our final crossing. The car is just across the stream. There was no way to get there. I'm thinking we're hours past our out time. The search party should be there. But I didn't hear anything. And I could see lights if they would have been there. And I took my team. We had one poncho that was still relatively intact. And I put everybody under the one poncho and told them to stay close together. And I stood outside the poncho and I flipped my caving light across the branches of a big tree above my head. Any self-respecting rescue team should come to a flashing tree in the middle of nowhere. But after an hour of nothing, I knew there was no rescue team. And I knew if we stayed put, we would die. And there was this fire trail that went up the mountain on our side of the stream. I'd been up it 13 years earlier. Been 13 years since I'd been up that fire trail. And I knew that 13 years before, there was a partially collapsed cabin up there a couple miles. And I was hoping there might be shelter, but at least I'd get my team moving for a couple more miles. And I talked it over with them. I said, we've got to stay together. Everybody has to make the move together. They agreed. And I put the contractor, 20-some-year-old contractor, in the lead and his wife, and I pulled up the rear. Couple reasons. One, I was going to motivate anybody that got too groggy. And the other one was, I'd been in and out of water repeatedly, and my legs felt like lead. Cold water. And I wasn't sure if I was going to walk all the way. But I'd read a story about a guy who went miles crawling after he couldn't walk. And I was determined I could make it to that cabin walking or crawling. But if it was crawling, I didn't want to slow my team down. So I pulled the rear. But my 10-year-old son wouldn't leave my side. And after a little while, I come across my niece, literally slapping her boyfriend across the face. I knew he was in trouble because I'd already seen his coat laying along the trail. When you start taking off your coat and dropping it when you're cold, it's not good. But I didn't have enough left in me to pick it up. I kept going, and when I found him, she was slapping him to keep him moving. I joined with her in persuading him. I didn't slap him. She did that. And he kept moving. It was embarrassing for him. He's the weightlifter. He's the big bodybuilder. Unfortunately for him, he didn't know that high-protein diets don't have the endurance of vegetarian diets. Who can go further, a horse or a lion? A horse. It was really embarrassing to this poor 19-year-old bodybuilder. He was the first one to really be in serious trouble. And a little bit later, I hear a yell up ahead of us, I found an outhouse! That's good news. There didn't used to be an outhouse up here. This was a fiberglass outhouse, handicap-sized. You can jam 8 people into an outhouse. Body to body, that's what you need anyway. I have slept in outhouses before, folks. When you need to, you have to. I'm thinking, there didn't used to be outhouse, keep looking. It was snowing by this time. And the contractor goes ahead just a little bit outside beyond what I could see, and he yells again, I found the cabin, come check it out. I get there, it's completely restored. It is now a historic cabin along in the Buffalo River National Park. And it's got a sign right on the edge that says $5,000 fine, 6 months in jail for breaking and entering. I'm reading the sign, and my daughter walks up beside me, and she looks at the sign, and she says, "Hey, Dad, it's warm, and they have food in jail." And I said, "Yeah, Jennifer, I was thinking the same thing." And the contractor and I did a little walk around the house looking for a way in. They've actually done a good job of restoring it. They put antique rippled glass in the windows. And I'm an antique glass collector. The only way in was through one of those windows. They have this hardware cloth, wire, over the windows. So we took the rock and we broke the wood strips that hold the wire on and we peeled it off with our hands. Then he took the rock and he punched through the window with it. I reached through, opened a latch, we opened the window, he broke, and I entered. I walked around to the front door, opened it up, and brought my team in. Inside, it was cold and empty, with one steel desk, with paperwork in the drawers on how to run a cave rescue in Fitton Cave. So this would use this place for headquarters for cave rescues. Great. I didn't even have a lighter to light the paper on fire. I try not to do that again, by the way. But there was a locked closet in the corner, and I had a Leatherman multi-purpose tool in my pocket. I pulled it out, tossed it to the contractor, and I said, "Find out what's behind that locked door," and I started working on the weightlifter. A few moments later, the contractor's in the door. He just took it off the hinges. And inside, he says, "Look at this." I look. There's miles of cables, spools of cables for communication during cave rescues. That's worthless. But there were three sleeping bags, a can of Coleman fuel, a Coleman stove, single burner, a Coleman lantern, three lighters, a can of corn, and a can of beans. Those are exactly what we needed to survive the night. And I took my 10-year-old and the weightlifter, which I'd stripped down to their underwear shorts, and I jammed them in a sleeping bag body to body. My 10-year-old, the weightlifter was not too with it. And I don't think he even knew that my 10-year-old was playing with his little nipple ring. But anyway. So he's in there. And we heated up the food, the two cans, and I would take a spoon of it and make sure he's conscious and give him a bite, another bite. We gave him a good chunk of it, and then we shared a couple of bites with each person. And we have these two guys in the sleeping bag. I lay the three teenage girls down. You don't say, "Hey, leave some distance." Jam your bodies as tight together as you can up against the boys. And I laid a non-zip sleeping bag over the top of them. I didn't have anything for underneath. All I had was a buff. And I put this over them. And then I laid down as tight as I could against one of my daughters. Tanya, the nurse, came in as tight as she could behind me, and her husband is on the outside edge. He had more body fat. That's why he got that position. And we lay there and shook violently. And I realized I'd made a mistake. I was laying on my cracked rib side. And I thought, but you know, you can't roll over because you're too tight together. And besides, I was not rolling over and going face to face with Tanya. I just kind of stay right here where I am. In the morning, we were still shaking violently. The sleeping bags were now soaked from being over the top of us. And I took one of them, and I went outside while a couple of people that were with me huddled around the stove. And I went outside, and I was listening for the sound of an airplane or a helicopter. I went out in a clearing beside the cabin, and I was going to wave and bring them on in if they came looking. Because I felt by now, surely, they've sent out the search parties. I knew we didn't have it in us to move any further. It was up to the search parties now. And I waited and I listened, and there was nothing. I finally came back in. It's now late morning. It's just miserable to the bone cold. And my daughter looks out the window. She said, "Something white's moving out there." She said, "Oh, it's just a waterfall." They were everywhere. A little bit later, she said, "If it's a waterfall, it has a national park emblem on it." I came running to the window, and there's this really big, tall, four-wheel drive pickup with a crew cab picking its way along the fire trail, over the logs and stuff on it. And I came out the front door and came around, and I meet a ranger getting out of his truck. And he's wearing a life jacket to drive a truck. He'd had a pretty tough day, too. And as I met him, I'm well aware of what the sign on the building says. I said, "Sir, I'm sorry we had to break into the cabin." He said, "I've just been hoping you would make it to this cabin." I said, "Sir, we got into the supply closet. The sleeping bags are a mess and a broken window. We'll happily clean them up and fix the window later." He said, "Don't worry about it. I'll take care of it." And I thought, when Jesus comes, I'm guilty of sin. And I'm going to say, "But Jesus, I'm just a sinner." And he's going to say, "Don't worry about it. I've already taken care of that." The ranger came around. Oh, I should tell you what my daughter Jennifer did. You see, she ditched her blue jeans because she realized they were deadly to her that night. When we got to the cabin, she ditched them. And she replaced them with a sweatshirt that was upside down. She's got her legs through the arm. And so when the ranger comes, she runs out on the porch, and it really is a ranger, and she jumps, "Yeah!" The ranger sees our 19-year-old weightlifter, and by the way, the ranger knew he was in trouble because he'd picked up his pack, his jacket, and other things driving up the trail. There were two other search teams out. They sent one guy in a truck in case we made it to the cabin. The other two were searching the stream sides for our bodies in case we tried to cross the stream. Our rope, the Atrolian Traverse that got me into all this, when we got to where it was underwater. And it started out 8 feet over the water. It was over a week before my car was able to be driven from the parking spot that it was in. But he looks at the weightlifter and he says, "Young man, I've got some clothes out in the truck. I'll be right back in." He brings them in. He says, "Here, put on this wind jacket and wind pants." He said, "I've got food out there in my warm truck." Weightlifter hears about Cliff Bars, energy food, and warm truck. He jumps out of the sleeping bag, grabs the wind pants and the wind jacket, and runs in his skivvies all the way to the truck like flags flying behind him with the clothes. We got in the truck and headed down the mountain. We got to a ford where he had crossed on the way in. He said, "On my way in here, I was crossing this ford." He said, "I got the duty because I have the tallest truck in the park." He said, "Partway across, the current grabbed the back of the truck. It swung downstream." He said, "I hit the gas and I prayed and I made it." So I'm literally talking to a man who risked his life to save ours. And now when we get back to that crossing, he says, "I want all of you out of the cab in the back of my truck. Put the life jacket on the littlest guy." He said, "You've got a fighting chance in the back of the truck if I lose it." What you know is if you're inside that vehicle, you don't have much of a chance. And he's putting his life on the line for us again. We went across the stream, got to our car, got our food and our clothes, left our car behind, and he got us out of the park. But from the time we were put into warmth until I stopped shaking was about 7 hours. It was cold. Be flexible. But do realize that God is still willing to rescue people who even do foolish things. God is good. New normal. Not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. I know how to be abased. I know how to abound. Everywhere in all things, I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Folks, whatever's happening, trust God to get you through. Don't worry about what you don't have. Deal with what you do and trust him with it. Truth matters. John 8:32. I'm going to go real quick through here. I'm skipping the stories that go with them. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Friends, if you know the truth, it will set you free from all the devil's deceptions. Make sure you're studying it in its context. Satan will take it and take it out of context to try and deceive you and destroy you. Truth matters. John 8:32. Risk to live. Let's look at that one. And he who finds his life will lose it. And he who loses his life for my sake will find it. What you know in survival situations is you have to risk your life to save it. Once you're far enough into it, what do I do? Quit taking risk and just die? No, you got to keep going. Spiritually, you've got to risk your life to share the gospel of Jesus Christ many times. Be willing to risk it to save it. And caring relationships and never give up. Here's the last combination with the last story. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some, but exhorting one another so much more as you see the day approaching. As we approach the coming of Jesus Christ, we have got to be trusting in God and have a fellowship of believers around us that is as well. And never give up, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but he who endures to the end shall be saved. Captain Al Haynes was flying a DC-10 from California to Chicago. As he took off and got up to cruising altitude, suddenly there was an explosion in the tail engine. There are three engines, one on each wing and one in the tail on a DC-10. And when this thing blew up in the tail, it took part of the tail with it. But, hey, after the explosion, he's still flying. He comes on the intercom and tells everybody, "You undoubtedly heard the explosion. We've lost our number two engine in the tail, but we still have each wing engine, and we can... they'll take us all the way in for a landing. We'll figure out what airport we go into for our emergency landing." Then he tries his flight controls after he switches off the intercom. There's nothing. He has nothing. He flips to the number two hydraulic system. Thankfully, he's got a backup. He tries his flight controls. There's nothing. Good thing they put three hydraulic controls on this plane. He flips the number three, tries his hydraulic controls. There's nothing. It has blown all three hydraulic lines, and he's lost his whole hydraulic system. It's the unthinkable. He radios in. He says, "I've lost all three hydraulic systems. How do I fly this airplane?" And the engineers come back and tell him he can't. Do you want a pilot who gives up? Or do you want one that cares about his family, himself, and everybody on that plane? And Captain Al Haynes really cared about everybody on his plane. And he wasn't about to quit. And he and another couple pilots on board figure out a plan. They have two wing engines. And they have a fuel pump that they can control for each one. That's the only control they have. And so they can either speed the engines up or slow them down with the fuel pump. Reader's Digest says, "It was about like driving a car from the top of Pikes Peak to the bottom with no brakes and no steering wheel by opening and closing the doors and windows." But if that's all you've got, gonna try it. And the plane is in a circle from the damaged tail. And by tweaking it, they can with the engines, they control the size of the circle. And so where they're going across the U.S. as it's looping across the U.S. And they calculated out that they're going to be flying over or relatively close to the Sioux City Airport. And so the idea is to adjust the circle and start lowering the speed of the engines and bringing the plane down so they can crash land it in Sioux City. Captain Al Haynes, after he's got a plan together, gets back on the intercom and tells everybody that they're going in for an emergency landing in Sioux City. And he says, I'm not going to kid you, it's going to be a really rough landing. And he goes through the bracing procedures and how to survive a crash landing. He says, I will give you 30 seconds notice before contact, or before we hit. There's a guy by the name of Jerry Schemmel on board who's listening to all this, and when the engine is blown, the first thing he did was ask, praise God, that his wife wasn't with him on that trip. Then, now he's asking God, help me help others today. And so, he's helping calm people down when they realize how bad this is, and he's memorizing where all the emergency exits are, so he can help people find them. And then he waits. And as they approach Sioux City, Al Haynes is cleared to land on any runway. That is not how you're told on an approach to a big commercial airport. They tell you what runway, what direction. They tell you what speed, what approach. None of that to him. You are cleared to land on any runway. The whole airport is yours. And he comes back and says, you want to be specific and make it a runway, huh? He's aiming for the airport because they can handle large casualty accidents. He is literally crashing this plane by cutting the throttles and trying to make it hit the airport. But he hits the runway right by the numbers. But he's not lined up perfectly with the runway. He hits it and goes right off at an angle. It hit so hard, he told them it'd be rough. It hit so hard it broke the cockpit right off the plane. And the airplane ran over it. It broke both wings off the plane and it broke the tail off the plane. The fuselage slides upside down into a cornfield and bursts into flames. Jerry Schemmel finds himself hanging upside down in his seat. He lowers himself to the ceiling, which is now the floor. And he goes from person to person, and he's helping them find the exits, which is really easy, the big opening on each end of the fuselage. Forget the emergency exits this day. And he's helping people out. Some people are alive, some people are dead, and eventually he believes himself to be the last living person on board that airplane. By the way, you have about 90 seconds before the fire burns through the skin of an airplane. He's doing this stuff fast. And by doing this stuff, he's placing his life at extreme risk. He believes himself to be the last person in this airplane, and he jumps through the flames and clears the wreckage. I mean, it's not like it's a big drop. He just runs through it. As he's running through, he hears the cry of a child from inside the plane. Jerry asks God to help him help people. He turns around, goes back through the fire, back into the burning plane. He's now in the darkness of smoke. It's daytime, but he can't see. And he's gagging and he's coughing and he's feeling for a child that's in here somewhere. He said, God, make that child cry again. He hears a cry. He goes to that part of the plane. He cannot find the child. I need another cry, God. He hears it. It's coming from an overhead bin, which is now the floor, upside down. He opens the overhead bin, and inside, I think it was an 11-month-old girl. She had been ripped from her mother's arms in the landing, gone flying through the air, hits an open overhead bin. By the way, I've been in landings rough enough to open overhead bins. And she hits the overhead bin. It closes as the plane's tumbling. And she's protected from all the flying debris. She's just got bruises. No serious injuries. He grabs her, sticks her under his jacket, and runs through the flames for the third time. Outside, he finds a mother in hysterics. And he is able to reunite a little girl with her mom. Meanwhile, they found Captain Al Haynes in a crushed cockpit. He was alive and he was conscious as they began to cut him out. And he asked them, "Did anybody die?" They said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Then I'm a failure." And they said, "No, sir, you are not a failure. More people have lived today than died today. That's not bad for an airplane that can't be flown." Al Haynes survived. So did most of his flight crew. You know, we need a fellowship. We're a lot like that airplane. And you need a church family. And some of you are a part of this church family. You're members. You're kind of the crew here. Would you want to raise your hand with me and say, "We want to make our church that kind of place that won't give up on other people no matter what"? I hope you are serious about that and you make this church that kind of a place. Also, maybe there are some of you that are wondering about, maybe you need a new church fellowship or you need a church fellowship. Is there anybody here that would like to say, "I think I want to check this fellowship out. I'm not saying I'm going to join it, but I want to check and see if it's that kind of a fellowship"? Is there anybody that want to raise their hand and say that? Yeah. Any others? Yeah. Others? Yeah. Members, make sure it's this kind of a fellowship. And for the rest of you, check it out. And if you've not been baptized anywhere along the line, talk to the pastor. He's going to be happy to help you fulfill that. All right? Jesus is coming again. You might be living through a disaster, but never take your eyes off the fact that he's coming again and there's going to be a reunion of all who love him and trust in him.